He's the creator, the architect of the universe, the one who fashioned the sun, heated it to 35 million degrees, and told it to govern the day. He's the one who molded a shiny ball 2,160 miles in diameter and gave it as a light to govern the night. He's the one who made 100 billion stars in the Milky Way and then hundreds of billions more in galaxies we've never seen. His fingers carved riverbeds, shaped mountain ranges, and decked the earth with flowers. He created man out of dust and woman out of man, and it was good. But the creation was lost to sin. The world became broken. And so Jesus became not just creator, but redeemer. We are twice loved. And though hell would cry out with joy on this day as the heavens grew black and the earth trembled, its victory was short-lived. This sin-cursed earth could not hold the sinless form, the majesty and glory of its creator. When we look at creation, we see God's hand. When we look at the cross, we see God's heart. There will never be anyone in history who loves us more than God does. And that love is symbolized by the blood of Jesus, the strangest, deepest, holiest thought of God. Why was blood chosen to pay for our sin, to be the substance that continues to cleanse hearts from the stain of sin? Because it was the strongest language God could use. God meant for people to know how terrible our sins are. And the symbol had to speak loudly. It had to speak across centuries and generations over cultures and customs and denominations. It had to break down walls, penetrate the hardest of hearts, and mend the most broken of hearts. The shedding of blood through the death of Christ was the only way the wisdom of God could preserve the holiness of God, display the justice of God while shaping the righteousness of God and demonstrating the love of God to those who deserved the wrath of God. He is worthy.
Thank you for this love, Lord. You're the name above all names, be exalted now in the heavens, as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names, be exalted now in the heavens, as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise.
Throughout Scripture, blood functions as a symbol for life. We see this in Leviticus when it says that the life of every creature is in its blood. The blood contained within a being sustains life, while blood removed from the body or the shedding of blood results in death. It's with this understanding that God forbids the consumption of blood and also the shedding of human blood, since mankind was created in the image of God. God does, however, provide specific instructions for the shedding of animal blood. most often in the context of animal sacrifice. God created mankind to be in relationship with him. Unfortunately, sin drove a wedge between God and his creation, making it impossible for unclean humans to enter the presence of a perfect God. So God created a system of rituals in which the blood of an animal could be used as a way for God to remain among his people. In these rituals, the blood of an animal would be poured out and then sprinkled or wiped on people and objects to prepare them to be in the presence of God. The blood carried three similar yet distinct functions. First, the blood made atonement for or covered over the sins of the people. Second, the blood would cleanse or purify people and objects from their ritual uncleanness. And third, the blood served as a consecration in order for God's people and specific items to be holy and set apart for God's purposes. This system served a purpose. It allowed God to be with his people, and it allowed God's people to experience the presence of a holy God. But this system was incomplete. Hebrews chapter 10 explains it well. The old system under the law of Moses was only a shadow, a dim preview of the good things to come, not the good things themselves. The sacrifices under that system were repeated again and again, year after year, but they were never able to provide perfect cleansing for those who came to worship. If they could have provided perfect cleansing, the sacrifices would have stopped, for the worshipers would have been purified once for all time, and their feelings of guilt would have disappeared. But instead, those sacrifices actually reminded them of their sins year after year. For it is not possible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. So what could be done to deal with that guilt of sin? God's people would need to look beyond the shadow of that old system to determine God's will for them. And what is God's will? Hebrews 10:10. For God's will was for us to be made holy by the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once for all time. And now today, as we look to Jesus and his sacrifice on the cross, we can go right into the presence of God with sincere hearts, fully trusting him. For our guilty consciences have been sprinkled with Christ's blood to make us clean. It is far too easy for us to live day by day, year by year, trying to manage that guilt and shame of our sin all by ourselves. Today, are you willing to look to the cross in order to experience God's will for you? His will to make you holy by the blood of Jesus once for all time. Thank you.
at the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for sinners such as I? At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Was it for crimes that I had done? He groaned upon the tree. Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. At the cross,
but drops of grief can never repay the debt of love I owe. Here, Lord, I give myself away. It's all that I can do. Oh, at the cross,
in these next few moments, I want us to reflect on the symbolism of blood in both our physical and our spiritual life. You see, blood isn't just a substance in our body, it's also a powerful reminder of the redemptive work of Christ. Tonight, I want to explore how the nature and properties of blood mirror the transformative power of Christ's sacrifice. Let's start by looking at blood as a source of nourishment. Have you ever thought about the network of blood vessels that travel throughout your body? Blood transports required nutrients all throughout that network. Without a constant supply of nutrients delivered by our blood, the body would lack the energy and building blocks necessary for proper function and proper maintenance. You see, without Jesus, we are missing our most important nourishment. In John chapter 6, verses 33 through 35, it says, For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. They said to him, Sir, give us this bread always. And Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst. We have access to the bread of life, which is the ultimate nourishment for our lives. Blood is also a source of balance. It plays a central role in maintaining homeostasis, which is the blood's internal, or the body's internal balance. For example, it's blood that regulates the fluid balance, which helps prevent dehydration. It can help stabilize blood pressure. Blood also helps balance our body's temperature by adjusting flow to release or retain heat as needed. Without our blood, the body would be out of balance. Similarly, a life without Jesus lacks balance. Another word for balance is harmony, and another word for harmony means peace. Colossians chapter 1, verse 19 and 20. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. You see, without Jesus, we can never experience true peace. Moving beyond nourishment and balance, blood is also a source of protection. You see, it plays a vital role in protecting our bodies. White blood cells and antibodies patrol the bloodstream and mark the antigens for destruction, helping to prevent infections and diseases and protecting our overall health and well-being. But it's not only our physical bodies that are in need of protection. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12 says, For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. I don't know about you, but that sounds really intimidating. How do I get protection from all of that? From cosmic powers, from the present darkness, spiritual forces of evil? Where do we find our protection? Revelation 12:11 says, And they have conquered him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. Jesus' blood provides spiritual protection from all those attacks. And not just protection, but ultimate victory. Praise God that Satan was marked for destruction by Jesus' blood. Blood is also a source of cleansing. Blood acts as a natural cleanser. As it circulates through the liver and kidneys, these organs filter out and remove the waste and toxins from our body. Blood is key to the process of cleansing throughout our entire body. As important as protection may seem, it's not the most significant aspect of blood. It's the ability to cleanse. Revelation 1:5 says, And from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of kings on earth, to him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood. 1 John 1:7 through 9 says, But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. My prayer is that if you haven't already, before the end of tonight, that you would allow Jesus to forgive your sins and to cleanse your life. That is the single greatest decision you will ever make. As we go into another song of worship, I want you to think, which of these properties of blood do you need most in your life today? Is it nourishment? Is it balance, which is another way of saying peace? Is it protection? Or is it cleansing?
Mark 14:12 through 13. On the first day of the festival of unleavened bread, when it was customary to sacrifice the Passover lamb, Jesus' disciples asked him, "Where do you want us to go and make preparations for you to eat the Passover?" So he sent two of his disciples, telling them, "Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him." So the arrangements are made, and Jesus and the 12 sit down for a meal. But something is off. Jesus and Judas have a quiet conversation, and then Judas leaves to fulfill his role as betrayer. And after he leaves, Jesus shares what we now call communion. But he does something that astonishes those who are with him in the upper room. He redefines the purpose of communion. And in order to demonstrate the order that the old covenant God made with Israel is no longer in place and that a new covenant is being established by Jesus himself, he gives the elements new meaning. In essence, Jesus says what once represented the freedom from the slavery of Egypt now represents freedom from the slavery of sin. The bread represents my body broken for you. And the blood represents what I shed for you, the cup. Now, the disciples, they didn't quite understand it yet, but Jesus' death is the centerpiece of his ministry. He didn't want us to focus on his miracles, as marvelous as they were. He points us to his death. His death achieved for us the forgiveness of God, and forgiveness is our greatest need, which makes Jesus' death his greatest accomplishment. John 18:1. When he had finished praying, Jesus left with his disciples and crossed the Kidron Valley. Now let's just pause here for a moment. Thousands of sacrifices were made in the temple on the day of Passover. The blood of the Passover lambs overflowed from the basins in the temple and they drained into the Kidron Valley. So it probably looked like the River Nile when the first plague from God hit in Egypt. Jesus had to traverse this bloody drainage to get to the Mount of Olives in the Garden of Gethsemane. So let's use this image to connect the Old Testament with the New so that you can see the significance of this moment. So we need to go back to Genesis when God called Abram, who would later be known as Abraham. Genesis 12, I will make you into a great nation and I will bless you. I will make your name great and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you and whoever curses you, I will curse and all peoples on earth will be blessed through you. Blessed because through Abram's line will come Jesus. Well, years pass and Abram still does not have a child. No child, no line. No line, no Jesus. And then God renews his promise by making a covenant with Abram. Now, covenant means to cut. They were cutting a deal. Making a covenant in those days involved physical cutting as well. An early example of what's true in the physical is true in the spiritual. A covenant in those days consisted of meeting in a ditch in which animals would be cut in half and all the blood would pool into the middle of the ditch. In bare feet, both parties then walked through this blood-filled ditch, signifying that if one of the parties breaks their word, breaks the covenant, their blood will be spilled in payment. And that's what's happening in Genesis 15. We read, so the Lord said to him, bring me a heifer, a goat, and a ram, each 3 years old, along with a dove and a pigeon. Abram brought all these to him, cut them in two, and arranged the halves opposite each other. But now, this is where this covenant is different from any other. Abram did not walk through the ditch. Only God. Verse 17, when the sun had set and darkness had fallen, a smoking firepot with a blazing torch appeared and passed between the pieces. God was saying, if either of us breaks this covenant, I will pay with blood. As the nation of Israel then settled into the land promised them by the old covenant, they began to disobey God. They're intermarrying with pagans and worshiping other gods. And when they did worship the one true God, it became legalistic, more about rules than relationship. So outwardly they worshiped, but inwardly their hearts were far from him. And this breach resulted in 400 years of silence from God and culminated in their rejection of his son, Jesus, the blessing that was sent to save them and equip them to be his chosen people to bring salvation to the world. The covenant was broken. Blood from God was required. So here's Jesus, the Lamb of God, walking through a valley filled with lamb's blood, like a symbolic reenactment of God's covenant with Abram. His blood, about to be shed, effectively ends the old covenant with the Jews. God said he would pay in blood while creating a new covenant with us. No more repeated animal sacrifices to seek forgiveness. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world once for all, takes away your sin if you put your hope and trust in him. You know, it's just amazing how this book, written by 40 different men on three continents and three languages over 1,600 years, has a supernatural harmony of theme and purpose woven throughout the narrative. It all connects. Now, Jesus is arrested, and after a night of beatings and mocking, after being crowned with painful thorns, he's crucified. And crucifixion was probably the most brutal and torturous death penalty ever devised by men. So his hands were stretched out wide against the cross, and nails were driven between two bones in the wrist. And as the nails were driven, they would pierce the nerve that travels up the arm and would cause excruciating pain. And if you hung this way for any period of time, the muscles around your chest cavity began to be paralyzed. You'd be able to breathe in, but you couldn't breathe out. Death on a cross would have been a simple matter of suffocation. Except the Romans didn't want to make it that easy. They'd take a person's knees, they'd bend them, and then nail the feet to the cross. So a man would hang there in absolute agony until the pain in his chest was about to explode. And then he would lift himself up on his nailed feet to grab a breath. And when the pain in his feet became unbearable, then he let himself back down again until the pain in his lungs once again became unbearable. And so that was Jesus' time on the cross, up and down, up and down, a slow rhythm of agonizing death. Eventually, soldiers would come and break the legs of the one being crucified to hasten their end. In the case of Jesus, they didn't have to break his legs because he had already passed away. But just to make sure, they stuck a spear in his side, and water and blood came out of the chest cavity, which, as doctors say, only happens if the heart rips. The sinless, perfect heart. That meant he alone was able to pay for our sins. Now, we deserve punishment, but instead we receive a seat at the table reserved in our name because Jesus paid for us. But it's more than just an intersection of humanity's worst and divinity's best. It's an exchange. It's a divine exchange. See, we come to the cross. We come to the cross with our human sorrow, and we find divine joy. We come with our human brokenness, we find divine healing. We come with our human pride and we find divine humility. We come with our human despair and find divine hope. We come with our human mistakes and find divine forgiveness. And that's the greatest exchange of all, that Christ exchanges his human death for our divine life. Death on a cross. I mean, isn't it ironic that an instrument of torture and death would become a symbol for hope and life? But that's how God works. He takes humanity's worst and he transforms it into divinity's best. He did it on the cross, and he's still doing it today in the hearts of his people. We know he has the power to do it, to transform our lives because of his work on the cross and his resurrection from death. Jesus was given the courage to face death, the strength to endure death, and the power to conquer death from his heavenly Father. And this communion table is a reminder of that day when divinity's best met and overcame humanity's worst. Jesus was killed by us. Our sin put Jesus on the cross. And Jesus was killed for us. His death and resurrection set the same stage for that same intersection, that same exchange to occur every day in our lives. As Paul writes in 1 Timothy 1:15 and 16, Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. But for that very reason, I was shown mercy so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display his unlimited patience as an example for those who would believe on him and receive eternal life. If you have not yet asked Jesus into your heart, if you have not yet claimed your seat at the table, you can do so this very moment by realizing your need for God's pardon, repenting of your sin, recognizing that Jesus died for you and receiving him into your heart as your Lord and Savior. And I'm going to be standing right here at the altar after the service for anyone who would like to know more or pray about having a relationship with Jesus. As we take the bread and the cup, let us give thanks for the great love of God that put divinity's best on the cross and gave us the ability to display that best to a lost, hurting, and broken world. I ask those who are serving us if you would come to the front now. We practice an open communion here, which means you don't have to be a member or a tender here. We just ask that you have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And please wait until everyone is served, and then Pastor Rod will come back and lead us to partake together.
Show some. we continue to prepare our hearts to receive from this communion table today, this evening, I want to read from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, starting verse 23. The Apostle Paul reminding the church about what this means. And he said, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat. This is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body." So we've known and we heard tonight about the bread, about the cup, and the meaning of both of them. The bread, of course, represents the body of the Lord Jesus Christ that was brutally beaten before he was even crucified. Many good men would not have even survived the scourging. You know, religious shows us sometimes that there's just a few marks on his back. But he wasn't whipped, he was scourged. And just really mutilated is the best way you could say it. And it reminds me of 1 Peter 2:24, where it says, by whose stripes you were healed. And then Mark 8:17, he himself took our infirmities and bore our sicknesses. So let us receive this cup today, or this bread today, in remembrance of what he did, what he suffered in his body. Let's receive it together. Romans chapter 5, verse 1 says, "Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom also we have access by faith into his grace, in which we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. And not only that, but we also glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance, and perseverance, character, and character, hope. Now, hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. For when we were still without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet perhaps for a good man, someone would even dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than having now been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him." I've heard it said that if we make much of the blood of Jesus Christ will make much of us. So this evening, as we partake of the element of the juice, representing the Lord's blood that was spilled for us, that we have heard so good about tonight, let us receive this by faith as well, in Jesus' name. Father, we are so grateful for your love that you have for us, that you did send your only begotten Son, Jesus, that if we would believe in him, we would not perish but have everlasting life. We thank you for the sacrifice he made in his body and through his blood. And we now can walk in victory, confident of his sacrifice, price that he paid for us, so that we can be more than conquerors through him who loved us. This we pray and we give you glory in the matchless, majestic name of our risen King, our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Countless stars ablaze, only one could breathe life into clay. Only one can quiet raging seas. Only one has power to. Quiet raging seas, only one.
Friday's here. Friday's here. One more time. Friday's here.
Sunday is coming.
Hallelujah. How about a yes? Sunday is coming. We hope you will join us or at least be with someone so that you can celebrate the greatest story ever told. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Would you please leave in the same manner in which you entered? And have a good night.